The international trade game is a simulation game, and it has a very simple setup. Students are divided up in groups. Each group represents a different country, and a country with certain characteristics. There are two rich countries, one middle income, and two poor countries. And students don't know that. So they are divided up in groups, and they receive an envelope. And in the envelope, you have some items. So you have some money, you have some sheets of paper, you have some shapes, you have some tools. Not everybody gets everything. The idea behind that is it's a very simple setup, and yet is informative, it's intriguing, and it's something that students get captured by early on in the course. So the game starts by trying to understand what can be done with what they have, and invariably, rich countries will be rich in technology and money, but will not have raw materials, and poor countries will have a lot of raw materials, but no technology. So that is establishing something that in the game needs or is the basis for interaction, for negotiating, for seeing how much it takes to get technology, or what is the exchange rate, if we want, between technology and raw materials. So relative prices is one of the concepts that is important. Theoretical concepts, assumptions, rationality, profit maximization or utility maximization that are typical of economic thinking is something that we produce in a realistic sense in a setup which is light enough for students to be comfortable. Here at NYU Florence, we customized the international trade game. We decided that could have been a phase, a preliminary phase of entering into the atmosphere or creating an atmosphere for the game and creating t-shirts. So these are simple t-shirts that students wear at the beginning of the game, one color per group, gives a visual distinction across groups. So gives an identity to a group, gives a sort of group spirit, a team spirit within the group, and the lines, the differences there are across groups. So there is a liturgy of vestition, if you want. When we record the international trade game, we understand what type of interactions, so it's a better way to keep track of the interactions that are going on. We have money that rather than being cut out, black and white photocopies are something that gives visually the different values and reminds us of some important characters. And then finally, we've created some personalized templates against which the products need to be compared to. We'll give money only if the students see that they actually conform to the specifications that they need. It has a first phase in which the students need to assess what they have. And there are aspects of disappointment. Of course, the poor countries will think that they had an uneven hand distribution, so they some get upset. There is a phase in which, having accepted that there is an uneven distribution of resources and technology throughout the world, they realize that they can use that inequality to their advantage, so they have to make the best out of what they have. And that is where we, as leaders, we encourage them to move around, and the second phase is a phase of information gathering, recognition, trying to understand with what they have, they can meet what other nations have. And that is also a phase in which, if you want, behavioral economics comes in, because depending on the personalities of the students in various groups, there is a sort of natural propensity to form a coalition. So the best outcome that we can have is one in which the rich and the poor country manage to find a way of forming a sort of customs union or a way of a free trade area in which they exchange one richness for another, raw materials against technology. in the interaction, you see that the background, the cultural background of students comes up. And that is interesting because it is an additional natural contribution to the game, having different approaches to negotiation, for example. It's interesting to see how different backgrounds interpret interaction, interpret negotiation. Investment decisions, whether they were successful or unsuccessful, is something that is measured by the economic outcome, but it could be related, and it is important that it is related to the amount of information and the type of information the students had during the game. From my point of view, it is a very important moment in which, at the very beginning of the semester, I managed to look at personalities and what type of interaction students may have once we put more substantive material on the table. So I'm gaining the first glimpse at what class dynamics will be when we discuss issues. The debriefing is really important. So at the end of the game, we give students an assessment of how they did, both in absolute terms, how much money they have at the end of the game. But we stress the initial conditions, so where students started from. First, they recognize, but that is easy, which type of country they were. And it is important during the debriefing to establish a sort of causal connection between how well they did in the game and their strategy, and how much positive behavior they put in depending on their strategies. Yeah, I think that the students learn interaction through understanding what their roles are, and so understanding what their personal incentives can be met or enhanced by cooperating with other groups.